You are listening to a Clarkesworld Magazine podcast with your host and narrator, Kate Baker. Greetings, Clarkesworld citizens. I hope this podcast is finding you extraordinarily well. This is our seventh story for the month of September 2024, issue 216. I hope that you are doing as well as can be. I want to thank you again for your ongoing support of the magazine, whether it's by via a subscription or patreon.com/Clarkesworld or clarksworldcitizens.com or telling a friend or just being here all the time to listen to this podcast or reading the stories or the nonfiction or appreciating the art. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. So thank you. If you've been an ongoing supporter of this magazine or if you're just joining us, please consider going to any of those methods and pledging your support today. It does help bring you these issues each and every month, and you are a part of making that happen. So our title is A Theory of Missing Affections. It is by Renan Bernardo. Renan Bernardo is a Nebula and Ignite finalist author of science fiction and fantasy from Brazil. His fiction appeared in Reactor/Tor.com, Apex Magazine, Podcastle, Escape Pod, and others. His writing scope is broad, from secondary world fantasy to dark science fiction, but he enjoys the intersection of climate narratives with science, technology, and the human relations inherent to it. His solar punk cli-fi short fiction collection, Different Kinds of Defiance, was published in 2024. His dark sci-fi novella, Disgraced Return of the Cap's Needle, is upcoming by Dark Matter Link. So, my dear listener, I hope you can sit back, relax, and let me tell you a story. The Injector of Lasting Vasoconstrictor Fluid for Eternal Wakefulness and Apprehension, or The Device of Ceaseless Panic. A syringe with a magnetite needle that would frighten even the boldest of souls. A torture device. But for my sister, Gata, it would be a piece of divine that shouldn't be on the Aldar Society Museum for Burnian culture. That pretty much sums up how we stand to each other. When they existed thousands of years ago, the Burnian cherished torture. I'm an Aldarish historian. I can legally attest that it's a fully researched and documented fact. I myself deciphered multiple Burnian recordings. They don't call it a torture device, fine, but they describe it as such, at length. I've seen the hollows. I've seen them pushing that syringe into arms, seen their pearlescent, filmy eyes waiting for a pained reaction from their victims. What Gata and I agree on, it's a relic. What we disagree on, it's not a powerful manifestation of the Burnian that should never be seen, much less touched, sullied, as Gata would put it. In our calls made through Lightbeam via the big door, we try to avoid leaning on those topics so we can engage in sisterly conversations. The best lakes to swim works, unsolvable science slash religion bickering doesn't. We also agree on the Burnian are an inextricable, essential part of our lives. But we disagree on the Burnian were a highly punitive, exobiological society, not gods intent on shedding knowledge and protection from afar. When I was 12 and Kata was 3, our fathers got divorced. Papa Iago raised me among writing desks, data sheets, hollow reports, and hundreds of books, most of them on Burnian archaeology and on the engineering of the warp gate that was under construction to connect our systems. Papa Jimiro raised Kata in a cradle of Burnism founded in his family's farm underneath a sleek layer of a dome and star-dotted skies, fruit of an atmosphere-less planet. She spent years listening to his homilies about how the Burnian are, for the Bernici, they're still around, the true gods, not creators, but guides and guardians, and how they should reach us, not the other way around. What we agree on? The big door is a problem of a practical nature. The warp gate connecting Aldar, my home planet where Kata lives, with Fiberstein at Burnian Space, where I came to live, is about to be closed for economic reasons. What we disagree on? Which one of us should cross it to the other side? I leave the big syringe behind, lock its glass cabinet, and stroll back to my office in the museum. On my way, I fetch my pad and send a batch of pics to Kata. Vacation week coming next month, I assure you that this time you don't want to miss the beautiful lakes we have around here. Beijos, your Jekia. Some sister blackmailing has to be okay, right? I enter my office. A service drone plops a pack on my table. Carrots with green beans, blended with shredded synth pork, a rough, almost laughable imitation of what Papa Jimiro prepared when I visited the farm. I turn on my wall screen, but quickly get nauseous. I push the food away and turn the wall screen off. Every news network now spoils my days with incessant announcements about the big door's imminent closure. Solve all of your outstanding issues. Decide about your future. Plan now. Don't regret later. Eldarish Gateway Ministry announces the big door will remain open for only another month, which makes my body shiver with the wrong kind of anticipation. A warp gate isn't something one should take for granted. The big door was always planned to be temporary. It consumes an unimaginable amount of resources that involve antimatter reactions and the synchronization of millions of security measures, routines, and automated systems and ships. Aldar has an entire moon dedicated to providing energy for maintaining the big door open. And now that it has fulfilled its purpose, bridging the gap between humans and the ruins of the Burnian, it needs to shut down. Without the big door, the trip between both systems takes 98 years round trip. With the gate, it's doable in merely 12 days. Later, in an unplanned future, the big door will reopen, even if at intervals, once its stupidly high startup cost is significantly lowered. No one doubts that. By then, I will be a bag of bones in an excavation site, and Kata's ashes will have been swooshed away like pollen from Papa Himiro's farm. Kata and I won't be able to see each other ever again when the big door closes. Not even light beam. Instant communication will be possible. And even though I didn't want Kata with me in the past, I spent my years hoping one day she'd abandon her nonsense and simply come to me to knock at the museum's door and say she just left all her life behind for a dark, shrubby planet with long nights, thick air, and a bunch of scientists and historians. When Papa Jamiro passed away last year, I didn't visit. I actually invented critical deadlines at the museum, adding them to my to-do lists. And when I called Gata days later, I expected, needed, the reprimands that would put me in my place and confirm that I'm just a bad sister, an abominable person, that I don't deserve her and we're best apart. But they didn't come. Kata remained the sweet, slow-paced sister I always knew, exuding the freshly baled tranquility of an evening in Papa Amiro's farm, where the horizon turns lilac under the glow of Aldar's two moons, and the pollinator drones buzz their way to their cozy charging pods after the end of their shift. The injector of lasting vasoconstrictor fluid for eternal wakefulness and apprehension is a rough translation from the Burnian ideogram cuneiform scripts, often found on files in their databanks and in some of their monuments. We also found exabytes of weird, highly saturated video recordings in hollows where I've watched the Burnian administering the injection on other people thousands of years ago. The subjects entered a state of constant panic and alertness, gaping all around as if something bad were always about to happen. When I was 20 and Kata was 11, I was sure something bad was about to happen if I kept her close by. Papa Iago said I could try to keep Kata under my wing, and Papa Jamiro approved of us living together if I could convince Kata to leave the peaceful aromas of the farm for the convoluted streets of the city and the scholarly, coffee-smelling corners where Papa Iago wanders. Burnian enlightened us to understand and accept even that which makes us sad, Papa Jamiro once told me. If your sister wants to go with you and Iago, it doesn't matter if I'm sad, because the net result is that there are more people happy in the family. But I ran from Kata. All I wanted was to study Burnian history, to reach the wonders that would be unveiled when the big door was completed and finally opened. I didn't want a younger, annoying, cumbersome sister at my side all the time to fill up my headspace with childish stuff like hollow cartoons and the Bernishi babble Papa Jamiro stuffed into her. That didn't fit the concept of freedom Papa Iago had seeded into me. That I was a woman who should seek my own truth, my own path, and find my place in a rapidly increasing universe. I wasn't like Kata. I wasn't content with a farm full of drones and ripe beets. Now, who am I to demand that Kata cross a gate forever, leaving behind not just the only home she's ever known, but all the things she believes, the core of what she is? Coming to Burnian space, to me, would sully Kata in ways I can't even grasp. But the alternative is doom. Coming back to the farm is burying my dreams in compost pits. I open the image of a Burnian being injected with the device. The contours of what seems to be a smile adorn their lips. I attach a note to the syringe on the Aldarish cataloging program. Mockery? The pacification and resocialization mechanism, or the device of unjustified calmness. It's a uniform. Green disc, dull and more featureless than a frisbee. It smells like algae and lies in a climate-controlled enclosure in a tiny annex at the back of the museum, accompanied by a stele that gleams with texts about resocialization and prison systems. During the day, that device is barely acknowledged by visitors, just a forgotten backdrop in the museum. Kata's image loads above my pad in prevalent green and a gleeful smile. The light beam call status informs us we have 10 minutes to talk. Well, how's the farm? I trace a finger over her light flickering cheeks. Most of the reprogramming is done by now. Kata has been managing what Papa Jamiro left for her, including all of the farm's automated system. She rolls her eyes. Our man used his fingerprints a lot for authorization. And what have you been doing? I ask. I crave a smidge of uneasiness in Kata. I want to suck it from her expression to find something that would take her out of her chair and make her want to fly. She doesn't have much to do on the farm apart from making sure all its systems are operating normally. Instead, my sister spends all her days reading and lecturing about Burnism to children in nearby towns. You know what I've been doing, Jekia, she retorts. If Papa Iago fed me with an itch whenever my life seemed to stop in its tracks, then Papa Jamiro fed Kata with the certainty that she doesn't need much movement to be complete. You've seen the leg pics I sent you, I say. The blackmailing? I chortle. She doesn't. And you've seen your cousins, she says. I sent a hollow a few weeks ago and you said nothing. I pinch my lips. Yes, I've seen them. Juana, Jeno, Amir, and Tunia. On top of a truck, baskets of apples in their hands. Juana trips and hers drops from the truck. Amir tries to help her and his basket also falls. The hollow ends with a pearl of laughter, instantly looping back to the beginning as if trying to give me uncountable chances of becoming part of their life. Well, we both know how to blackmail each other, I say, my welcoming smile turning into a serious one, meaning we can't postpone some talks. Have you been receiving the constant nudges about the big door? Kata nods. Can't you come to visit us? She says. By us, she means herself, our cousins, our aunties, the hallowed friends of Papa Amiro, and probably even the damn drones. You know, before. I'm stuffed up to the lid of my head in work, Kata, I say. I sound blunt. There's no other way I can sound. We've just excavated new sites that could point to the reason why the Burnian went extinct, and I stop. Dangerous grounds. You could come, couldn't you? The farm doesn't need you. Kata grinds her teeth. You know I can't. She closes her eyes for a moment in what I think is a moment of reflection. Speaking of that, she mutters. Her lips become a taut line, caution scribbled on them. Can you turn your pad a bit to the left? It's because I can't right now, I say. Tears brim in my eyes. I know why she asks that. Behind me on a shelf is a Burnian candle holder, a simple stylized jar to hold flashlights in place, found in one of the first excavations. Bernishi can't look at Burnian artifacts. One of their dogmas states that they can't lay their eyes on what the gods have built. Bernishi don't attribute the nature of their gods to some kind of supernatural force. They acknowledge the Burnians' existence as physical entities in the universe, but they deny they're dead for thousands of years and think humanity has no business in the home of gods, since they're just waiting for the right moment to visit us and bring us enlightenment on their own terms. The Burnian have been a part of our lives for at least 4 centuries. When only one of the 7 Eldarish expeditions to Fibrestein came back with artifacts of a supposedly extinct civilization, a frenzy ensued on what should be humanity's next steps. As is to be expected of a first contact situation, even though one end of the contact was a long dead, slender race of humanoids with jeweled eyes, bald head, and sagging environment sensitive skin. Kata stares at the screen. For a moment, I think the connection has been lost. Light beam data transfer is unstable and constantly suffers interference from Fibrestein's thick atmosphere, but I see Kata moving to end the call without a word. The absence of anger is torture. The pacification and resocialization mechanism used to be installed in air vents in rooms that were filled with subjects to be tortured. It released an invisible gas, something of which we still don't know the composition. Hours later, every subject left the room in an orderly fashion, not a line of worry in their lukewarm eyes, a procession of insouciant souls ready to walk freely across the weirdly spiraled streets of Burnian cities. I try to reconnect the call. I flood Kata with messages. I breathe in deeply and try to feel angry at her. Religion is the problem. That's the easy argument. It comes swiftly into my mind. But it's not true. Science itself is made by bitter people fighting each other for a different number of truths. The Eldarish society often finds itself flummoxed by decades-spanning quarrels over the pointy head of a spear found in the bowels of a cavern. So I can't blame the fact that Papa Jamiro nurtured Kata in a way I don't approve and never wanted for myself. His way of showing love was spending long afternoons on the farmhouse porch with brewing cups of mate, telling never-ending stories about the Bernian, backed by Zezin, his drone. I blurted out to fill in any gaps of Bernishi dogma Papa occasionally left out. When I was 17 and Kata was 8, I started leaving the porch before Papa Jamiro began his preaching about the Bernian. I found myself something else to do, a book to delve into, a quiet corner to long for a message from Papa Iago, saying he'd send a shuttle to get me before Papa Jamiro tainted me with his prolixity. He never did. Papa Iago respected Papa Jamiro, despite their different views on life, and it was I who was supposed to manifest my annoyance if I ever wanted to. I never said a word, fearing to hurt Kata. But all a young girl with an acne-stuffed face and a historian career in her bag of dreams wanted was to rebel at her religious father, to yell some hard adolescent truths at his face, and to dash away thinking she's ready to conquer the world. I stand, take the Bernian candle holder from the shelf, and tuck it in a box. No matter how I try, there's no anger in me, just a guilty kind of frustration. The involuntary activator of attachment neurotransmitters, or the device of endless love. Love is torture. That's indisputable. When an Aldarish team extricated a tiny chip from a cracked Bernian skull and accessed its data, I had no doubt about what I was seeing. Once in a subject's head, the chip forced them to produce all the same hormones that we associated with love. They could even channel this love towards someone else, to an object, or even a government. At the time, I'd been so disgusted by the tool that I opted out from its initial research. A colleague showed me hollows of 7 Bernian under the influence of the device in a seemingly utopian villa. Yes, they seemed happy, excited, and enamored with each other. Yes, I don't doubt that they felt the pleasant draps of love. The record showed they'd been subject to an experiment unwillingly. They'd been forced to be happy. And that's worse than being sad. Notifications pop up about the activator, a couple of news articles, 3 papers, and 2 interviews. I suppress them for now. The activator is one of the most studied Bernian devices. It was one of the latest found by the society from a period about 1,200 years after the resocialization mechanism, or the injector, meaning the Bernian either evolved their technology to make it smaller and less detectable, or augmented their own brains and bodies to become devices of their own. After that period, we don't have much. It was like they simply vanished from history, as no evidence had yet been found to explain why they were no longer there. I access the folder with more pics I took from Fiberstein's lakes. In one of them, I edit out the ruins of a Bernian tower that Kata wouldn't like to see. I attach the pic and start writing a message to her. I sigh and delete it all before sending. There was a lake on the farm. Kata called it Big Nose Lake because it looked like a girl with a protruding nose on a map. Its crystalline waters gleamed with the restless lights reflected from the dome's own reflections, a mirror of mirrors, showing off the lights from the closest cities. Walleyes and perches swam on the lake, and an islet with a lonely tree shyly jutted from its middle. I called it the Isle of Kata. My sister belonged in that lake. Every day since she was a child, she swam in it. First accompanied by our fathers, later with our cousins, friends, her girlfriends, or alone together. She went all the way to the islet and back. It became her morning routine as much as checking the Aldarish Society's news became mine. When I was sociable, I swam with her. "What will you do when the door opens?" she asked me once, our backs against the tree. Papa Miro's tunes floated all the way over to the water to touch us. I was 26 then, already deep to the neck into Bernian history. She was 17 and learning to program farm bots. "Are you curious?" "Well, of course I am," I avoided eye contact. Talking about the Bernian had become a taboo in our family since Papa Iago and Jamiro created a schism by divorcing. "I'll enlist to go through the door." "And live there?" I nodded. Kata remained in silence for a good 5 minutes, her head slowly swaying with Papa Jimero's soft voice crooning about the starlight that would shed in us all and seed our dreams. "I am too," she finally said. "Curious. We can go together. I stuttered, my heart hammering in my chest. I felt like desperately snatching those words from her, as if her curiosity was a short-lived seedling that needed to be watered by me. She was Bernishi, all right, but who would confine a young, curious girl? You can begin your studies now. We can learn a lot from the Bernian. I can help you. That girl that once didn't want her younger sister nearby was no more. I don't want to study. I already know. I just want to go. But I already know. She knew nothing. No one knew a thing about the Bernian. That was the purpose of opening a damned gate in the first place. You know that you'd probably see Bernian stuff, right? I'd say. Well, we can go to places far from their country. The Bernian were the apex species of their planet, but according to the first expedition's reports, they only inhabited 35% of it. No other intelligent species had been found on Fiberstein. We'll see. We swam back to the farm and found Papa Himiro snoozing, surrounded by the comforting whir of Zezin, with a book sliding from his lap. The Story of Taking Care, a short sample of Bernian literature translated by the society, in which the Bernishi embraced as a piece of gospel, a religious paradox that they seemed to accept, since it was based on a piece of scripture they shouldn't be interacting with. I took it and laid it on the table. After that day, my visits to the farm became scarcer. Throughout the years, I always considered it was a matter of time until Kata came to me. It never made sense to go back and dive into a life of comfortable myths. The logic path was Kata coming to me, embracing the truth, my truth, because it was founded in science and years of knowledge. In my mind, that girl who once told me she was curious would just wake up and surf the path through the big door. We would swim in the Bernian lakes, and we would descend scarcely lit stairways to find amazing underground secrets left by a civilization gone thousands of years ago. We could even have a farm there. If properly treated, Bernian soil could be as fertile as Aldar's under the dome pastures. The thing about love is that it doesn't go away when you want it to. It clings, glues, adheres. And even when you think it's gone, it's still there, a sticker that never fully comes off. I roll my terminal screen to check on the summarized news about the involuntary activator of attachment neurotransmitters. Lots of historians have been releasing papers and new data on the items collected by the museum due to the big door's imminent closure. One historian has unveiled a video of what supposedly was a clinic where the Bernian underwent surgery to implant the activator. I touch to watch it. There are four Bernian walking into a pear-shaped building. A knot curls in my stomach. They're not marching into a fake villa to be implanted with the chip. Their expressions, smiling eyes and outgoing gestures, much like our own, creasing on the flaps of their folding, multicolored skin, reveal joy. They're there of their own free will. The only torture those Bernian were facing was the one imposed by a good kind of anticipation. The cognitive emotional stimulant of endogenous opioids, or the device of fools. An adhesive patch with a thin spout where the substance used to be inserted at the time of application. If the Bernian could fabricate love with a chip, they could manufacture hope, too. Once the adhesive was applied to someone's skin, it took 7 hours for the effects to kick in. The subject developed a surge of folly. One of their records tell the story of a Bernian who spent years hoping the skies would descend and bring them stars. It's an emergency, I say to Montana. She's an Aldarish Gateway Ministry official, and all I need her to do is to escalate the report I quickly drafted with some colleagues from the society. The big door can't be closed. When I decided to pick torture devices to study among so many layers of Bernian culture, I did so out of spite. I couldn't believe that an intelligent species that had the capacity to develop high levels of technology, many of them surpassing our own, could dedicate so much effort into torturing their peers. If Fiberstein's excavation sites, the society had unearthed about 743 advanced torture devices, were ambiguous enough, encompassing more than a millennium of Bernian history. Some Aldarish experts assert that the Bernian were, in fact, a highly educative people, which had the improvement of the self and of the whole as the basis of their society, a line of thought tangentially shared with a Bernishi dogma. I've never dedicated too much attention to it because given the massive amount of records left by the Bernian civilization, it was obvious they weren't really trying to hide the punitive nature of their devices. But what had just been pointed to by the historians analyzing the involuntary activator of attachment neurotransmitters added yet another layer to the use of those devices. Experimentation. I filter my database without hanging up the call with Montana. A list appears on the screen, ordered by the Bernian timeline chronology. There are only 7 in the last 200 years of their history, all extremely tiny or microscopic, mostly brain implants. What do you mean, collecting skulls? Montana says. Her frown looms on the hologram. She shakes her head. You can stay on Fiberstein and do whatever research you want if that's what you desire. Solve all your outstanding issues. Decide about your future. Plan now. Don't regret later. In late Bernian history, we have less and less evidence of the Bernian using their devices for torture. We were focusing at a very specific period of their history where most of their records are in obvious databanks. But later, they started recording and doing lots of things in their heads.
Are you saying they abandoned their devices?
Not exactly. It seems their devices remained an integral part of their lives, but used for something else, perhaps, and implanted in their skulls.
And there's more. I know there is. I can't be sure of anything. There's no documented research, no concrete evidence. It's more of a gut feeling, but when I left home and all the possibilities of having a life close to my family, it was 100% based on an anti-scientific gut feeling. Here, let me show you one of them. I say, loading a model of the involuntary activator of attachment neurotransmitters. I touch the screen to share.
Don't, the official says, her cheeks taut with tension. A notification informs me that Montana has refused the file. I bite my lips and mouth a sorry. I shiver, all the vibes of Kata hanging up on me coming back at once. We politely end the call, but my request goes through and appears as pending. Even though I can just stay on Fiberstein to do my research, not many scientists and historians have the same idea about remaining on the planet. Just 38 of us opted to stay. People have roots and homes, cousins and sisters. Almost the entirety of the society living on Fiberstein chose to go back to Aldar. When the big door closes, the lives of those who have decided to live at Bernian space will become so much harder. A price to be paid for science, for history. We'd be closer to the source of our studies, to the things that make our eyes shine. But we'd be light years from our origins. Whatever Montana thought of my request, I must have pulled the right levers. Because 4 days later, the ministry announces an extension of 3 months for the closure. Enough to collect skulls. 12 Bernian nights later, the stars whisk and bend past me as I fly through the big door in a shuttle. The facilitator of holes, or the device of ungrief. A bracelet, unimpressive, no outstanding features or symbols on it. Once wrapped around someone's wrist, it could only be removed by severing the hand. The facilitator of holes is the cruelest of Bernian devices. It expunged grief and made its subjects question their feelings and sensations. How can you have loved someone if you don't miss them once they're gone? How can you feel at home if you don't feel anything once it's taken from you? That was the basic premise of the facilitator. As was the case with the activator, I also refused to be part of the initial research on the device. I never missed the farm. When I cross the arched gateway bearing the name of my father, Amiro Serene Country, I feel nothing except a hole within me, occupied by the absence of everything I could have been through the years. The lovely sister, the joyful cousin, the diligent farmer. The house is still there. It's white, decorated with slightly peeled floral patterns, its paneled windows glinting with the lights of the dome above. New kinds of bots now trudge along the fields, their supple, spidery legs knowing exactly where to step, specialized hooks coming off of their bodies to carefully select potatoes, beets, and carrots. I brought this for you. I extend a rock to Kata. It softly gleams in green and blue. She recoils. It's not a Bernian artifact. It's from one of the lakes. Her eyes don't hide a deep curiosity, the kind I longed to see more often when we were younger. She touches the rock. It shines brighter as if greeting her. Bioluminescent microorganisms, I say. Beautiful, isn't it? There are tons of it up there. I was keeping it in a box that imitates their natural environment. Blackmailing? Kata smiles, pulling me into a hug. And there are things you don't know you miss until you have them back.
I wonder if the exploited Bernian lost that sense with the bracelet. I came to stay a while, I tell her that night, the lampposts in front of the house casting an orange halo over us. The aroma of freshly cut hay and the earthy scents of the farm don't mean as much to me as the ironclad dust of Bernian ruins, but they're okay. And I have to ask you one last time, I promise. Is there any chance of convincing you to move up there with me? Kata shakes her head. I peer into her eyes looking for a logical answer. I can visit before the closure, she says, fumbling for a middle ground. As long as it's far from their lands. I want to see the lakes, but... Her mouth hangs open. What? I demand. Could I trust you? Bernism doesn't go to the people come to it. Bernism never had big ambitions of reaching out to all the 8 inhabited bodies of the Aldarish system, and instead is content in having its substantial share of followers in Aldar itself. Kata never tried to convert me, never tried to make me who I'm not. If anyone has tried it, insensitively fiddling with a conversion, flashing the dubious glories of a life that meant nothing to the other, it was I. And dreaming of swimming in Bernian lakes with my sister, I brought discomfort into our lives. I may have wanted that you become me. An extension of me. I grab Kata's hand. But that has changed. Kata pulls the rock closer to her chest. It blankets her face in Viridian. Do you still have that book that Dad used to doze off on whenever he brought it out to the porch, I say? It's old, but I do. Why? Do you think the Bernian felt love? Kata frowns. Did you come to question my beliefs, Shekia? I came to make peace with it. The story of Taking Care was Papa Himiro's favorite book. It's short, with barely 80 pages, and it's a kind of fable about a Bernian who finds themselves caring for a stranger, then reflecting from where that sensation came from. The interesting thing about it is that the narrator mentions they only felt that need after entering a room full of gas. Marked as a mistranslation in the society's databases, the passage has been marked for revision. But there's no mistranslation. My bedroom in the farmhouse has since been transformed into a library with several Bernian manuscripts translated by the society. I ask Kata for a mattress and spend my nights on it, perusing the house's manuscripts and accessing dozens of papers on my pad. Kata insists I should visit my cousins on the neighboring property. I have something else to do first. No piece of Bernian literature, of any epic of their civilization that has been consistently studied, contains emotion in the way we're used to. No characters under distress for a loved one. No mother grieving a lost child. No epic quest after a long lost home. Even their records never mentioned it, except when they referred to their peculiar devices. And even then, they treated emotions as the product of an induced reaction, as we'd describe the melting of ice. It could have been some sort of taboo describing them that way, but I doubt it. Even taboos are not homogeneous throughout an entire civilization. They're gods, Kata told me. They don't need feelings as we do. But they did want them. If I'm right, they wanted it so bad they began experimenting on feelings. Lost in their whims, they started inventing devices that produced all the hormones and neurotransmitters that stimulated something that either didn't feel or felt at a substantially weaker and disorienting level. I jot the ideas down on my pad. Kata enters the library at the end of my first week on the farm. You never change. After all this time, you came to be stuck in here. I'm trying to keep us together. How? She frowns. By keeping the big door open. I finish the initial draft of a paper with only 3 days remaining until the big door's closure. When there are only 23 hours left, I submit it to the society. If they find it worthy of deep study, they'll have the leverage to keep the big door functioning indefinitely. Later that day, I leave a note for Kata and my cousins and row to the aisle with a meal of shredded synth pork and 2 big tents. When my cousins arrive, hours later, they barely talk to me, except for a few silly jokes and formalities. I don't blame them. You need to go. Tears trace down Kata's cheeks. She pulls me further from the tent. You're going to miss your flight. You barely had time to meet your cousins and have a decent meal with me, but I guess that's you. I'm sorry. What were you writing? I smile and squeeze her hand. It's just... I'm learning some things here. About them? About us. The Bernian grain of sand, or the device of extinction. We will find out it's a chip the size of a grain of sand or even smaller, present in the most recent skull remains of the late Bernian period. We will find out that they had inserted it early in their lives, essential as a vaccine for infants, and it flooded them with all the sensations and emotions their civilization had unearthed across their history. Entangled in their cranial implanted, unregulated feelings, the Bernian entered a state of struggle that ultimately led them to destroy themselves. But we will find evidence some of them roamed far from their lands, to the craggy ravines beyond Fiberstein's wide lakes, and we'll dispatch probes through these lands to find out the Bernian are still out there somewhere, falling in love, caring for an elderly papa, foolishly hoping the skies would descend and bring them the stars. That night, on the aisle, lights glint off the dome. Could have been my flight going back home, my only home, to all the things I prized and loved, to science and history, to the hardly comforting and dusty streets of the Bernian ruins, to the arms of the society. I try to convince myself that the net result is that Kata and my cousins are happy that I'm staying. A peal of laughter tears the whispery night, rippling across the lilac-painted lake. Cousin Amir tells some story about misconfiguring Zezin in another language. Kata recalls Papa Amiro's loud snores. I snuggle closer, happy that another door has opened. What are your thoughts on the story? You can send us an email. I'm Kate at Clarkesworld Magazine.com, and that is Clark with an E. We have one more story left for you for the month of September. And then, thanks to your support, we have a whole new issue coming for you for October. I do hope you can come back and listen should you so choose. And until then, my dear listener, I bid you a very fond and hopefully very temporary farewell.